All right, so here's another question. So what does Voidstar mean in C? If I were to just show you the code V-O-I-D star, what do you suppose that means? So take a second and read these answer choices and see what you think. So it turns out that actually void star is a particular type of pointer. So a void star pointer is what's referred to as a generic pointer. We don't have any information about what it's pointing to. This can be useful in certain circumstances, but in general, it's something that we want to avoid in this course because it can lead to using pointers incorrectly. If you do have a void star and you know what it's pointing to, somehow you know with out-of-band information what it's going to be pointing to, you can still use that pointer as you would a pointer of that type by casting it. And this is an example of what that would look like. This is, of course, very dangerous because if you're wrong, then you're basically causing an invalid memory access, which... In the best case is going to cause your program to crash, and in the worst case is going to cause it to subtly or silently corrupt data. And so you should be using this sort of thing very, very sparingly. And one place that we will use it where it is safe in this case is the return value of malloc. So if you look at the documentation for malloc, malloc takes a number of bytes, or the number of bytes that you want from the heap, and returns a void star pointer to the memory that it has allocated. So since you requested a certain number of bytes, presumably you know what you're going to store there, and in that case, it is safe for you to take the void star pointer that malloc gave you and cast it to the specific type that you know you allocated enough space for. So for instance, here where we allocate space for an array of doubles, we know that it's safe to go ahead and take that void star and cast it to a double star so that we can use the memory that we've allocated as an array of doubles. All right, true false. Malloc always returns a pointer to heap memory. So if it returns a valid pointer, it will always return a pointer to heap memory. Unfortunately, malloc can fail. And one potential cause for malloc failing is that you have a memory leak in your program that has filled up all the available memory in the process's address space. And if that happens, malloc is going to return null. And there are some other error conditions that might cause that as well. This will, of course, cause a segfault when you try to use the pointer because it's a null pointer. And so you really need to check for this every time you call malloc. And you need to find a graceful and informative way to fail. In this course, basically, if you can't allocate memory for something that you need, that's basically just at that point you really just need to abort the program, and that's fine in the case of this in the context of this course. So what you should do is you should print a message and then just abort the program. So for instance, that line that we saw in the previous slide. So we allocate space for a double array, we cast it to a double star, and then we check to see if it's null. And if it's null, we print an error message, and then we just abort. And so you can just include code like this whenever you call malloc or one of its related functions. All right, true false. If malloc succeeds, so if it does give you a valid pointer, it will clear or set to zero the allocated memory before returning the pointer. So as we mentioned when we first talked about malloc, this is not true. Memory is uninitialized by default, or I should say it's going to contain whatever data is in the memory that was allocated for you. Some runtime systems will zero out the memory, but you should not rely on that. And you should manually initialize values if you need to useful defaults if you need to rely on them. One way, easy way to do this is with memset, which you can use to set all the bytes in a given region to a particular character value. It's often used to zero out a structure. You could also copy from another region with memcopy. Don't use this for strings because it doesn't append a null terminator. Or if you do use it for strings, make sure you get the null terminator as well. And one other alternative that I'm going to encourage you to use in this course is something called Calloc. So Calloc is an alternative to malloc. It works slightly differently, so you should look at the documentation for it. But basically, in addition to allocating memory for you, it will also zero out all that memory before it returns a pointer to it. It is slower than malloc because it's doing all of that zeroing out. But in my experience, this works better when you're learning C, because having memory zeroed out for you helps to find a lot of helps avoid a lot of silent data corruption issues. All right. So last question in the C technicalities section. So what does this code do? So printf %s null. So we're trying to print a string, and the string that we're passing it is null. So what do you think? Is this going to segfault? Is this going to segfault? Is this going to print null? Is it going to print zero? Is it going to erase the entire hard drive? Oh dear. Or is there not enough information to tell? So take a second. Maybe go try it. Try it on a machine. Preferably one that you don't mind if the entire hard drive is erased, right? Okay, so if you are, in general, if you're attempting to dereference a null pointer, you'll get a segfault, right? We talked about that. So A is entirely a reasonable answer here. One might think that this might segfault. If you tried this on an actual system, I believe if you do this on Stu, you'll actually get B, where it will print null in parentheses. But in fact, the correct answer here is E. There's not enough information to tell, and in fact, it could potentially be any one of these. And the reason I'm talking about this is because it highlights an issue with having a standardized language like C. In that the C standard doesn't specify everything about how C should be compiled. So we've already seen this with respect to integer types. So we said that the standard specifies minimum integer sizes, but not exact integer sizes. The reason that the standard doesn't specify everything is that it allows a lot of room for the compiler writers to do reasonable things on the architectures that they're targeting. So for instance, we already saw a place where a compiler might want to insert additional space into the layout of a struct in order to align its fields and increase performance. And so it turns out, if you read the spec carefully, printing a null string pointer is actually undefined behavior. So here is an excerpt from the C standard, and I've highlighted the part that's important here. So it says that if an argument to a function has an invalid value, such as a null pointer, the behavior is undefined. So what that means is that it's up to the compiler and runtime system implementer to decide what is going to happen. So if you had a particularly pernicious compiler writer, they could write their compiler such that when you print a null string, it would generate code that would erase your entire hard drive, and that compiler would technically be standards compliant because the standard didn't specify what to do here. So in any case, you're unlikely to run into these situations in this course, but it is important to be aware of both the benefits of using a language with a standard, as well as some of the corner cases where perhaps you need to be a little bit careful about making sure that you're not relying on non-standard behavior. So if you're relying on your compiler printing null instead of crashing, which is what happens on Stu, then you're in trouble, because if you ever run your code on a machine that does crash instead of printing null, then you're going to your program's going to crash and it's not going to print null. So in any case, these are a lot of C technicalities that we've just gone over, and some of these you may run into over the course of the semester, and that's why I wanted to address them, just to make sure that if you do run into them, that you will have at least, hopefully you will be able to sort of remember that we talked about these things and maybe come back and remind yourself about why things are happening the way that you're observing that they're happening.